Hi, in today's video, let's take a look at this Datum Symmetricom 8040 Rubidium frequency standard. I have always wanted to get a frequency standard so that I could calibrate my own test gear here in the lab. Quite a few of the instruments you see here on the shelf, for example, the HP 8350, that's the one sitting on the top, that microwave frequency counter, the HP 8642B signal generator, and the HP 8566B spectrum analyzer, and my newly acquired Recordana 1992 frequency counter. They all use ovenized crystal oscillators. And these oscillators, while extremely accurate, they do drift over time due to aging, so they would require to be calibrated once a while. I did calibrate most of my OCXOs not too long ago using a borrowed frequency standard. But it is always good knowing that I have the capability to calibrate on my own. Anyway, most of the rubidium oscillators you can buy secondhand nowadays are from decommissioned cell towers. These rubidium oscillators in the used market are quite a bit pricey these days, and the price has been going up ever since Dave Jones did a video on it a few years ago. Back in 2012, for example, you could easily get a nice used FE5680 for under $50, whereas right now you'd be lucky if you could get one for $150. Anyway, the rubidium frequency standard I have here is a Datum Symmetricom 8040. The history of the ownership of these companies are actually pretty interesting. Datum originally acquired Aphrantum in 1994, and then Datum itself was acquired by Symmetricom in 2002. And finally, in 2013, Microsemi acquired Symmetricom. So judging from this history, this frequency standard is at least 20 to 25 years old. So I got this unit from eBay, which was listed in working condition, so we'll see later whether or not it locks. I haven't actually powered it up. But let's just take a look quickly at what we have out here. And actually, it doesn't really have much. It doesn't even have a switch because, you know, these kind of frequency standard, you typically just plug them in and never need to unplug it. So hence, we don't have the power switch. But back here, we have a power outlet, power IEC connector. And it says model 8040 with the LPRO, so that's low profile rubidium oscillator. And interestingly, here we have a demo tag, written on it. So here are our three frequency outputs, and actually there was a sticker here, but that one fell off. But it seems like they had reconfigured this output sometime after the oscillator was made, because right here, you have a 5 MHz, 10 MHz TTL, 10 MHz sine wave. And the actual, I think this sticker says is actually this one is for 10 MHz and 5 MHz and 1 MHz. So we'll take a look at what is inside. And here we also have a monitor output of the RS232 connector. So there's really not too much outside. And the unit is very light. So I'm not sure what to expect inside. To be honest, I've never seen one of these kind of off-the-shelf rubidium standard before, so I actually don't know what we should see inside. But let's take the lid off and we'll see. I think that's all the screws. And now we should be able to lift this cover. Well, it's kind of flimsy. So the overall layout actually is quite simple. Well, simple as all in relative terms, because we have all the physical package and the rubidium oscillator is in the separate module. So that actually has the majority of the circuitry here. And back here, as you can see, this is our frequency divider, and given that we have 1 meg, 5 meg, and 10 megahertz outputs, I assume that this one actually comes in, and the original frequency comes in, and we generate the 3 sinusoidal outputs. Now, what is interesting, I just actually realized, is that if you take a look at the board on this end, so this board is actually not connected at all. So here you can see this is the power input, and whereas our power is dangling right here. So, and even though it has a RF connector here, but if you follow this RF connector, you will see that the other end is actually not connected. So I'm wondering if they had so many different options, and also this one said it was a demo unit. So I wonder if it had to be reconfigured sometime during its lifetime. And so right now only this board is utilized. Later on we can kind of take a look at exactly what this board does, but judging from the circuitry here and everything on this board are all the 74 HCs. So this board definitely is only going to be generating the TLL signal that some of the options had. So if you look at it here, we have 74HC160, so this is a decade counter, and we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, is this another one? I can't really see, but we have quite a few of these decade counters here, and that is probably to count it down to obtain the 1 pulse per second signal. And we'll take a look at that later, but the board here, so this one, let me just zoom in a little bit. This one actually is the driver to provide our sinusoidal output. And if you look, also we have 2 ripple counters. These are the 74HC 390s. So this counter is going to be providing the 1 meg, sorry, not 1 meg, the 10 meg and the 5 meg signal that we see. 10 meg, 5 meg, and 1 meg signal that you see in the rear panel. And because this is the outputs here are sinusoidal, so they can't just use this digital circuitry to divide the signal, because that would be a square wave. So what happens is that they have the filtering stage here. So all these, as you can see, these are the, let me see what these are. These are the LH0033s. So these are actually the high-speed buffers. And they're using these and some filters, as you can see here at the bottom. Yeah, the RC filters to provide the low pass to the sinusoidal output. And then besides that, there really isn't too much to this, because here is our actual switching power supply. And one thing is a little bit interesting about this switching power supply is that you can see that the input, so here is actually the mains input, and here is actually the output. They're right next to each other. And also some of these wires have become frayed, and but I assume that it will just be fine. Now, another interesting thing is, if you look at back here, so I can lift this a little bit. So this is actually that serial connector, and it's actually not connected to anything. So I'm not sure what the deal there is. Maybe this is for another option that we don't have. Anyway, so now I'm not gonna take this rubidium oscillator out, because this is just a standard LPRO, so low profile rubidium oscillator 101, and there are tons of pictures online about it. I'm not sure if you can read this. That is actually very interesting. This says vibration test may have magnetized cover. So this is going to be interesting, because as we know, the rubidium frequency standard actually does get affected by the magnetic field. So the magnetic field would shift the actual frequency by some, you know, small amount. But given our typical application for our own, you know, lab standard that is only going to be accurate to, let's say, 0.1 hertz, 0.01 hertz. Any of those small variations won't be too much of an issue. But I thought it was just interesting to see that. Now, according to the expiration here, it says the warranty expires 1998, the 39th week. So this unit, at least the oscillator here, probably was made in 1995. So that's like 22 years old. And if you look at the data code on the unit, that's somewhat consistent. So these ICs, these high-speed amplifiers, are made in 1998, and some of these 74HCs were also made around, well, these were made in 89, but they were made around the same time. And one more thing we can see is basically how this works is there is a lock signal that comes out, and you can see that one actually snaked around to the board here. So basically we have two lights here. One is power, the other one is the lock. So what happened is that when this rubidium frequency achieves lock, that signal gonna be coming here, and we will see that the lock signal light would be turned on. Okay, so now let's plug it in, and after it's warmed up, we will take some measurements. But it does take 3 to 4 minutes to warm up. While it's warming up, actually, let's just take a look at how a rubidium standard works. And it's actually rather complicated, but I'm just going to give a 10,000 feet overview. So basically, this really relies on the hyperfine transition frequency of the rubidium items. In fact, not just rubidium items, but most of the alkali family atoms all have similar properties. That's why you have the cesium standard as well. So anyway, so what is going on for most of the rubidium standard, this one included, is that, actually I'm just taking this right out of the one of the patents that is utilized by this LPRO101 Wikipedia page. But anyway, so most of the rubidium frequency standard starts with this rubidium lamp, which is a rubidium 87, and it passes through one of its isotope, this gas-filled chamber. It's a rubidium 85, and the reason for that is actually, if you take a look at this hyperfine transition frequency diagram here, is because the frequency spectrum of these two hyperfine frequency lines of the 87 and the 85, actually one of the peaks overlap, so that we can use the 85 to filter out one of the peaks, so that you have one peak to work with. So that's the primary reason why we have a separate cell there. And then it comes to this cell that filled with the rubidium 87, and then at the same time, we have this microwave excitation frequency that coincides with the transition frequency of roughly 6835 megahertz. So that is 6.8 gigahertz. And so we can use that frequency. Once the excitation frequency matches the absorbance of this two hyperfine frequency energy line, spectral line, then we can detect a dip at the output light. So the light intensity dips ever so slightly. That is only roughly about 0.1% of the light intensity. So detecting that can be very tricky as well. And that's why, by the way, when the unit gets older and older, you know, the ability to detect that small dip becomes harder and harder, and at some point, you know, you won't be able to detect anymore, and that's basically the rubidium standard, you know, you can't use it anymore. And so for this whole thing to work, you know, it's actually quite intricate. And there are quite a few articles and by some of the amateur scientists or some of the original literature, you can see what exactly the rubidium lamp looks like inside of the LPRO-101. Anyway, so as we were just talking, it just achieved a lock. So the first thing we want to test is how accurate that 5350B frequency counter really is. And remember, we calibrated it a few months ago. So I'm curious to find out. And let me just set it up and we will take a quick look here. I'm actually right now putting this into the 10 megahertz output. And let's take a look there. By the way, all the lab equipment, if you look at these, they are actually all powered on standby mode, all these ones using OCX, the ovenized oscillators, so that the oven stays warm and so we don't have the warm-up time. Okay, so let me start that, and we will put this and as you can see, actually, the result is quite impressive. It is really bang on, which is, not that surprising because I just calibrated it. But that does give you some confidence that that both the rubidium frequency count, rubidium frequency standard, and the counter was working properly. So that counter is only going to be accurate to one digit after hertz. But as you can see, it's very stable, and there's nothing else going on here. So I happen to also had my newly acquired Rakodena 1992 frequency counter. I had it on standby, warmed up for about an hour now, so it should be stabilized already. So now let's take a look at how this counter stacks up. And let me just remove that a cable here, and we'll hook it up to the Rakodena counter. And as you can see, it's actually pretty accurate as well. And we are just about, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, we're about 1 ppm off, which is, it's probably within the spec. And for now, I'm just going to leave it as is. I'm not going to tweak it for now. So while we have this whole thing set up, why not let's take a look, also take a look at the clock reference for the 8566B. Sorry about that, hang on. The spectral analyzer and also my 8642B signal generator. So let me turn those up. And we'll take a look. And it does take a little bit of time to warm up, but once it's done, we'll take a look. So for that, I'm gonna use the frequency counter we just verified that it's 10 megahertz spot on. So right now, I'm gonna disconnect. Hang on, let me just get the cable back here. I'm gonna disconnect the rubidium standard. And so let's first do this spectral analyzer. The spectral analyzer has a CAL signal output. It's a 100 megahertz. So we will hook it up here, 100 megahertz. And we will hook it up to the frequency counter. So let me do that. And it's almost bang on. So, it had drifted a little bit since I last calibrated it, but nevertheless, it's really just 5 hertz off the 100 megahertz. So that's actually still quite impressive. Now, let's take a look at 8642B. So for that, I also have this its own reference, actually, output from its back. So that's the cable here, and I will show you here. as a cable here. So I'm gonna swap this out with that cable, and we'll see how well it stacks up. Let me just zoom in here. Let's disconnect the spectrum analyzer and connect. So this one is actually more has left had a less drift than my spectrum analyzer. As you can see, it's only like the last least significant digit, which is 0.1 hertz out. So basically, that just tells you, you know, like, well, there was some drift. Nevertheless, the all the clocks are actually very, very accurate. So I'm pretty happy about that. Now let me just turn off all those noisy fans, because that's one problem of those old test equipment. They do tend to have very noisy fans. So now let's take a look at whether or not we can figure out how this board works here. And as I mentioned earlier, this board that I presumably it's a outputting a 1 hertz per second pulse, as we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 of these 74 160s. So the 7 decades down, that would be 1 hertz from 10 megahertz. So first thing first, I wanted to do is to make sure that we do have this 5 volts, 5 volts output on the power rail. So let's put it here. And so this is the 5 volts. I, by the way, just cut off the cable ties, so I can access these without having to bend the whole thing. So let's see here. I'm just gonna do this very crude way because I don't have any adapters here. So yeah, it's a 4996. So it's, you know, give or take, it's a really bang on. And so we will plug this in and we'll see, whoops, we'll see what's going on with this. I'm pretty sure it's just a, you know, plugging in and it will should work. So I wanna make sure we have this on the right direction here. Okay. So we plug this in, and I'm gonna find a cable, and we will try to see the signal on our oscilloscope and to see what's going on. And I happen to have some sections of cables that would fit into these, and I just made a quickly adapter, and we will plug in, I assume this one. I don't know which one is which, but one of these which should be outputting 1 hertz per second. So let me power on the oscilloscope and we will see if we can see the pulse output. It takes a couple of seconds to warm up. And we see nothing. All right, so let me adjust a little bit. Just want to make sure that there's nothing set up was wrong. So right now it's a 5 microseconds. It's way too, let's turn on the intensity here. Oh wait, I'm not sure if you can see this. There are some tiny dots, okay, here. So which means there's something that was triggered. So let me just adjust the trigger here. I don't know how well you can see it. So my suspicion is that actually, so let me just zoom it in a little bit. Turn it down to 1 volt per division. Yes, as you can see, so probably, you know, one trick of this kind of oscilloscope is you can kind of adjust this trace to be outside the view. So now you can see the turn on the intensity. So if I move it down, and now you can probably see the pulse going through. So now, my suspicion is that the pulse output, the width, is really short. So actually this is one of the weakness of these kind of analog oscilloscope. So let me bring my Rigel oscilloscope and digital oscilloscope, and we will actually take a look to see if we can capture that pulse more accurately. So here is my good old Rigel DS1052E digital oscilloscope, and it's a little bit of old now by standard today, and I probably at some point will upgrade to a better scope, but for now this actually satisfies everything that I do. Now I'm going to zoom in a little bit so we can see better. So we're going to set it up for single shot. So single shot is very useful for measuring these kind of very narrow pulse that at a longer interval that you might not otherwise see. So for that I will go to the trigger menu, and the sweep right now is set to auto. I'm going to do a single shot. And I also wanted to set up the long memory capture because the pulse width is very narrow and we wanted as many data points as possible in that measurement so we can actually see what's going on. So for that I'm going to go to acquire menu and set the memory depth to long memory. Here we go. So I think that's all we need. Oh, and actually we need to, let's see, just try to adjust the channel. I'm going to do 2 volts per division because that's the cable I'm using is a X times 1. So hang on, let me just set that up too. Let me see the channel 1. Probe, okay, so I already set it to times 1. And let me move it down here maybe. I'm going to set the trigger level to be somewhere here, so it will trigger as soon as we, oops, sorry about that, as soon as the pulse hits that threshold. And I'm going to adjust time scale down to maybe, let's see, 200 millivolts per division, then we should be able to capture a field. Well, let's do 500 millivolts and 200. Okay. So that's actually pretty much what all we need to do. So let me plug our output. Let me unplug it from my Tektronix 2465, and if it comes out here. So this trigger output right here. Oh, you can't see here. So that was presumably the 1 pulse per second output. So I'm going to plug that directly into this the channel 1, okay? And as you can see, let's run it again. So we have 2 pulses. How far are they apart? So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So this tells me that these are indeed 2 pulses. The pulses are 1 pulse per second, okay? So let's capture a few more. So by adjusting the time scale shorter, let's do it again. Time scale longer, rather. So it will take some time. So as you can see here, we have these pulses spaced at 2 divisions. So right now we're at the 500 millisecond per division. So that is your 1 pulse per second pulse. Now let's take a look at how wide this pulse is. For that I'm going to capture it, I think, at a shorter interval here. So let's just do a capture, single shot again. And I'm going to zoom it in. So that's where the long memory comes in handy. I'm going to place in the middle and zoom in. Okay, so we're losing this. It's not really. Okay, here we go. So at 10 microseconds per division, we're roughly looking at a 20 microseconds pulse. And that's why you couldn't see that very well on an analog scope, because our pulse duration is so short compared to the cycle. And I'm just curious to see what the other outputs from this this circuit board looks like. And I'm going to actually put this here to the next one. Okay, so let's capture another single shot here and see if we can figure out something. Let me just go get it back here to 200 milliseconds, that's good. And let's do it again. Okay, so this one is also a 1 pulse per second output. And let me see the other one. So originally I had thought, because they had 1, 2, 3, 4 inputs, or whatever, like 3 outputs, sorry, they would have a 1, 5, those kind of a different decades output. But I guess I'm wrong on that. It seems like, though, actually, now I'm looking at this, probably these are just the input. And these, if you see, we have quite a few unpopulated ones down here. Maybe they're for different options. And the different options would have different type of division here. So, okay, so that makes sense. I was hoping that pulse output would be more symmetrical, like close to a 50% duty cycle, but I guess that's what this board was built for. Unfortunately, I can't find any specifications for this board, so I don't know what the original intended function was, but from this output, it's pretty clear that it's just for pulses. By the way, one thing interesting is, I forgot to show you, is I'm not sure you can see this, I need to tilt it. This board is actually quite interesting. This board, even though it's just some standard 74 series, it's actually a 4-layer board. As you can see here, it's 1, 2, 3, 4, the 4-layer. So that makes tracing the output very difficult, because a lot of the signals routes in the inner layer. And but anyway, so I think what I'm going to do is, at some point, I will make a pulse expander so that I can use this 1 pulse per second output to trigger this expander to make the pulse more symmetrical and with a higher duty cycle, so that it's easier for me to consume, at least. And also, I'm going to put this output to the rear panel. And this one doesn't come with a power switch, so I think I'm going to have to add a power switch, because I don't intend to have it on 24/7. And for my lab use, at least, it's only once a while for calibration. So I think that pretty much wraps up this video. And for any future modifications, I will definitely make another video. And so I hope you enjoyed the video. And if you did enjoy the video, please give it a big thumbs up. And do remember to subscribe. I will catch up with you next time.